Hallelujah.
Anyway, today's lesson is called The Trying of Your Faith is More Precious Than Gold. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We're going to take a moment and have prayer, and then after that, I'm going to let Sophia read us a scripture. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's pray. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father Yah, we thank you so much for this day, Father Yah. We thank you so much, and we ask you, Father Yah, to bless us. Hallelujah. Barak us, Father Yah. Guide us. Give us understanding, Father Yah. Hallelujah. We know sometimes, Father Yah, we can go through some things in this life. Hallelujah. Sometimes we can be so heavy in our spirits because of the trials and tribulations that we go through on a regular basis. So, Father Yah, we need your help, Father Yah. We need you to comfort us, hallelujah, with your comforter, hallelujah. Comfort us, Father Yah, and help us through these trying times. Help us to get by, Father Yah, through no matter what the situation may be. It may be physical, it may be mental, it may be in your health, hallelujah. You may be going through something on your job, hallelujah. But Father Yah, we ask you to help us, Father Yah, in all our situations. Help us, Father Yah, meet our needs, Father Yah. You said in your word, hallelujah, Father Yah, that you would give us our needs. You would bless us our needs, Father Yah. We're asking you, Father Yah, fulfill our needs, Father Yah, according to your riches and glory. Hallelujah. Father Yah, we need you. We need you, Father. Hallelujah. We can't make it without you, Father Yah. We need you to guide us. We need you to help us, Father Yah. We need you to help us to get through this thing that we're going through. Hallelujah. We need you to give us strength. Hallelujah. We profess right now, Father Yah, before all heaven. Hallelujah. That we are strong. Hallelujah. We are strong people. Hallelujah. We're strong minded. Hallelujah. We cast off weakness right now in the name of Yahuwah. Hallelujah. Father Yah, we thank you, Father Yah. We pray that you bless this message, Father Yah, that's about to go forth, that it may be food for the souls of your people. Hallelujah. Amen. In Yahushua's name we pray. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Sophia.
Proverbs chapter 3, verse 1 and 2. My son, forget not my law, but let thine heart keep my commandments. For length of days and long life and peace shall they add to you.
Wow. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Wow, add long life to you if you keep his commandments. Hallelujah. This is all in the scriptures, you know, that we're supposed to be keeping his commandments. And I just don't understand how people can think that you could live a reckless life and expect to be with Yah or to have a long life and you living a reckless life, you know. It just don't make sense. But anyway, let's go right into the lesson. The trying of your faith is more precious than gold. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. More precious than gold. I want you to think about this, okay? You all know Daniel. Not Daniel, I'm sorry, David. Okay, David. I read some scriptures in Psalms. Some Psalms that David, that was of David. And you see, sometimes we think that David didn't go through anything. We think that he was pretty much handed a crown, that he didn't have to go through anything to get that crown. And see, what most people don't realize is that David suffered so much before he actually became king. And most people don't understand that. He was literally in exile, running from Saul. For years he was running from Saul. Saul was after him to take his life. David had to actually get the upper hand on Saul two or three times, and he spared Saul's life just so Saul can just okay, Saul, now back up off of me, man. I could have killed you, right? And then next thing you know, here Saul said, okay, you're right, my son David. But then that demon would get back in Saul, and he's right back on David again. You know? Time and time after time, David was forced to go and live among the Philistines at one time. And so you got to think about this, right? Think about the stress and all the things that he had to go through. being an Israelite. But what was it all for?
Trying with his faith to work patience.
To work patience. Mm-hmm. It was trying David because the Most High knew that I can't just let you become king. You got to go through something. Hallelujah.
Yes.
And the problem is we wanna be up here. Just set me up on high on this mountain. I don't want to have to climb the rocks to get there. Huh? Just pick me up and put me up there, Father, y'all. You know, and the Father said, no, I need you to climb this one. I need you to know what it's like to have to climb over these rocks and slip and fall every now and then. I need you to know this. Why? Because once you get there, you'll understand what you had to go through to get to that point.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why he takes us through some things from time to time.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Let's go to 1 Peter. Hallelujah. This is 1 Peter chapter 1, and we're going to look at verse 7.
Okay, 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 7 reads as follows, that the trial of your faith, being more precious than gold that perishes, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto praise and honor and glory at the appearance of Yahushua HaMashiach.
Now, it says the trial of your faith be more precious than gold. Why? Because the trying of your faith is building something up in you.
Yes.
Huh? You, in order to make gold pure, you must purify it by fire.
Mm-hmm.
As that fire burns out all these other things, all these other metals that's in it, it burns it all out so you have your gold.
Mm-hmm.
That's what it's for. It's that he's trying to make you into something that's precious.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes we fight against the trials and tribulations that we go through, but there's a reason why we go through this. Now, sometimes we think we ain't supposed to go through nothing because we're let Yah's child.
Mm-hmm.
Now, all of us feel that way. Even the prophets felt that way. Now I got a scripture. Okay? Mm-hmm. I got one for you here. Let's go to Matthew, and I want you to really pay attention to the language of the scripture here. Matthew chapter 11, and this is going to be verse 2 through 6. And this time I think I'm going to have, let's see, Sophia, I'm going to have you read it. Matthew chapter 11, verse 2 through 6.
Now when John had heard in the prison the works of Yahshua, he sent two of his disciples and said unto him, art thou he that should come, or do we look for another? And Yahshua answered and said unto them, go and shew John again those things which ye do hear and see. The blind receive their sight, and the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, and the deaf hear, the dead are raised up, and the poor have the gospel preached to them. And blessed is he whosoever shall not be offended in me.
Okay, now, I don't know if you can read between the lines here, but there was something going on here. Now, there's referring to Yochanan the Baptist, John the Baptist, okay? John the Baptist was in prison awaiting his death, okay? Now, he remembered when he had baptized the Messiah, right? And he knew who the Messiah was at that time. Oh, this is the Messiah, this is he, you know, and I'm not worthy to, you know what I mean? John, he knew who he was dealing with then, right?
Mm-hmm.
But because the Messiah left him in prison and then come and rescue him out of prison, John was sitting up in prison, was probably like, man, he out here, I'm hearing all the stuff he doing out there for everybody else, but here I'm this prophet, came to make your way straight, and you gonna just leave me here in prison? Do you see it? John was sitting in prison, and he's sitting there in prison, and he said, what? He said, art thou he that should come, or do we look for another? Well, wait a minute, you didn't doubt before. When he came and you baptized him, you knew who he was. Now all of a sudden, after sitting in prison and the Messiah didn't come and deliver him out of prison, he's doubting now. So how did the Messiah handle it? He said, don't go and tell him nothing. Don't go and tell him that I'm the Messiah. Just go and tell him about the works you see. Think about it. He told him, he said, just go tell him what you see. That's all. See, the Most High was trying John's faith. He was trying his faith because he wanted him to understand, yeah, I know you're in prison and you're going through, but the trying of your faith, right? It's hard because none of us want to experience what he had to experience, being in prison and then being killed. And he was beheaded. Okay?
Yes.
No one wants to experience this, right? But even the Messiah was crucified, right?
Yes.
Most of the apostles were killed. But I guarantee you, their reward for what they went through far surpasses anything they could have gotten down here on earth. And I bet when they look back at it, they're glad they went through it, you know?
I want to kind of just touch on today's time, how we sit today and we look at our troubles and our trials a lot different than they did.
That's right.
But like you said, you even pointed out that even they had doubts, but it wasn't like it is today. The scripture tells us to think it not strange concerning fiery trials, which are though come to try you as though some strange thing has happened. But we today, we feel like we're exempt from all of that and that we shouldn't have to go through anything, that it should be smooth sailing. That's a scary position to be in because the scripture told us how our state of living would be as Israelites in the land of our captivity. And if things are too good, you have to ask yourself, what's going on? Am I walking upright? Because I've seen people make comparisons to determine that the fake Jews are actually the real Jews. They say, well, look, they're rich.
That's right.
They look at the first part of Deuteronomy chapter 28, and they say, well, they match up to the first part of Deuteronomy 28. So they have proven themselves to be the real biblical Israelites. But no one group of people on this planet has ever proven to be completely righteous. No group, not us, not them, no other racial group has proven to be completely righteous. So no one can determine anything by someone having material wealth.
That's right.
You see, we look at the scriptures too that talk about righteousness. Righteousness exalts a nation, but sin is a reproach to any people.
That's right.
And so when we see all of these other exalted nations, with all their monetary gains and all these other things, we say they're exalted because they're righteous.
That's right.
That's the perception that we get. And this is why a lot of Israelites don't want to cleave to who we are, because it would mean that we have been unrighteous. Because we are in reproach right now.
That's right.
It says sin is a reproach to any people. And we also don't understand what reproach is and what sin is.
That's right.
Scripture says sin is the transgression of the law. But yet we've been told on numerous occasions by many different groups that there is no law to abide by, that we no longer have to keep the law. And so we can't figure out why we are still under reproach.
That's right.
It's because the enemy has tricked us through false religion, false teaching. And so we are going through this vicious circle. But one thing we've learned on a personal level, when the scripture talks about the trying of your faith, right? One thing that we have learned is that the Most High is going to continue to send you through that same thing over and over.
That's right.
And over until you get it right.
Wow.
So if you feel like you're going in circles spiritually, then maybe you should just tough it out this last time so you don't have to continue to go through those same things, because that's been the pattern that the Most High takes. If you're doubtful of things all the time, maybe you should just stick it out and say, I'm going to trust the Father no matter what. Because he will continue to take you through that thing until you are purged of the idea of not trusting the Father. This is why things seem to stretch out in our lives as people. We wonder why is this thing not going away? It's because we are not allowing ourselves to be purged.
That's right.
We are holding on to the things that are separating us from the Most High.
That's right. You know, it's amazing what my wife said here, that you'll continue to go in a circle over and over through the same thing. You'll continue to go through it when you don't learn your lesson. Okay? And sometimes the Most High, he has some trials. I mean, to be honest with you, when you really look at the story of the children of Israel wandering in the wilderness 40 years, when actually taking them a couple of months to get there, that's just enough to make you say, wow. They turned a journey that shouldn't took but a couple of months into a 40-year journey because of their stiff-necked and hard-headedness. Wow. So the Most High, we are the problems. We are our own problems. We are the reason for the trials. That's a hard one. I want you all to know we are recording this on two different cameras, so we will upload the video from the other channel, from the other camera, later on if I can. If I can get it uploaded today, that'll be fine. You can watch it later on, because I know it's kind of distorted going live, and we do have plans for doing something else. You just gotta bear with us for a moment, and we'll be giving you a link or something to what we're going to be doing later on to try to make our Shabbat lessons a lot clearer on Shabbat. Okay.
It's out of our control, family. We have horrible internet service out here, so.
Yeah, absolutely. Hallelujah. So now, we're going through. And sometimes the Most High wants us to go through. Now, a person may ask this question, say, well, wait a minute. What did John the Baptist have to go through that for? It wasn't like he was living in sin. This man was living out in the wilderness. He was preaching Yah's word. He was a prophet, you know. But the Most High, sometimes he has a purpose for things. Sometimes he take us through trials and tribulations that may even cause a person's death. I noticed the statement that Apostle Paul made, a list of this statement. Let me go to it here. This is in, I'll get this for you. Just bear with me 1 second here. Okay. This is in 2 Corinthians. And chapter 4. And we're going to look at verse 11. And listen to what he says in verse 11. Okay. For we which live are always delivered unto death for the Mashiach's sake, that the life also of the Mashiach may be made manifest in our mortal flesh. So then, death worketh in us, but life worketh in you. So basically, he's saying, we're going to be delivered unto death for your sake, so that you all don't have to die. Because we have to start this thing, and the Most High is going to start it through death. He's going to bring in death through his apostles being killed. What that does is it does something to the faith. Okay? I know it's hard to understand it, but it actually, that's why they realized after they killed Martin Luther King, it's, oh boy, now we'd have made him a martyr. And now his movement grew even more after he died, because they didn't realize that's actually what happens. So when the apostles were killed, it actually caused our brothers and sisters to grab a hold of the teachings even that much more. It caused us to be, it grew more, you see. And sometimes that's how the Most High does things. Think about it, right? You got a seed. Let's say you got a piece of corn. You got a corn on a cob, right? Can you just take that seed off that corn on the cob and just plant it? Nope. What got to happen first?
It has to dry up and die.
It got to die first, right? Before it can bring back life, it has to die first, okay? So that's
and
why...
And when it comes back,
yep,
it'll give you more than one grain of corn. It gives you several,
that's right,
more hundreds of grains.
That's right, yeah. You see? So that's why he said, except the grain fall to the earth and die, it cannot bear much fruit, you see? Now, in our life, I'm going to say this, you are like a grain of corn. And the problem is, you won't die. He's trying to get you to die. Now, when I say die, I'm not talking about just a physical death. Mm-hmm. He's trying to get you to die to self. Mm-hmm. Okay? He's trying to get you to die. That's why I used to love that song by the Whiners. Self has to die out.
Yes.
Love that song. There's no more I in this here house, right? Mm-hmm. We got to get ourselves together, knowing you are soon to gather us. You hear that?
Yes.
Any day. So what is he saying? Self gotta die,
mm-hmm.
right? When you're like that grain, and you refuse to die, you cannot bear much fruit.
That's right.
Because you cannot bear fruit of yourself.
Mm-hmm.
You have to bear fruit, you have to abide in the vine, right?
Mm-hmm.
So when you die, you bring forth life. What life? Yahushua's life. That's what What did he say? He said, I die daily,
mm-hmm.
yet not I. I am crucified with the Mashiach, yet not I.
Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but yet not Yahushua I. that lives in me.
Yahushua that lives in me, that's right. So when you think about what he's saying there, that's very important.
Mm-hmm.
So the Most High, what he does is he allows these trials and tribulations to come upon us, and they come upon us, and they're supposed to work out that you, get you out of the way. That's what the trial and tribulations are for. It's to work something out of you so that now it's no more you that's in the way, and now the Mashiach can stand up in you. Now, if he stand up in you, what do you think he's going to do? He's going to do the same thing he did when he was on earth. He's going to tear Satan's kingdom down. In your life, he'll tear Satan's kingdom down.
Mm-hmm.
Everything in your life that you struggle with, if you allow him to, he will bring those things subject under your feet.
I wanted to go back to that corn real quick. Mm-hmm. Or any seed. Now imagine if we are the seed. If we are alive and we refuse to die, and you try to plant, if you try to plant a live seed, okay, that seed is actually going to rot underground.
Yep.
If it's alive and it haven't experienced death, it's just going to rot away.
That's right.
And I think that's what's happening with us in a spiritual sense, because we refuse to die. We plant ourselves in the ground as if we are trying to bring forth fruit. But because we don't know the process, we go and we just rot away. The cares of this life.
That's right.
Just actually choke out the word. We just rot away, wither away, and we just die completely.
That's right.
To where we can't be used.
That's right.
Because we didn't die first. We tried to live. It says, he that shall save his life shall lose it.
Wow. And he that loses his life for my sake.
Shall find it.
Wow.
And so we have to experience death. There is no ifs, ands, or buts about it, family.
Yep.
So I guess we need to stop fighting, kicking, and bucking and go ahead and experience this death. It doesn't feel good because many times you are giving up things that your flesh loves. Okay?
Yep.
And when you give up things that your flesh loves, it's not an easy transition. But if you want to continue to press, part of that pressing for the prize of the mark of the high calling, which is in Yahushua HaMashiach, is to die. That's a part of the process. And so once we get that in our minds, instead of trying to continue in our way, which
seems right
to us sometimes, there's a way which seems right.
That's right.
We were just talking about the Christian pastor, Zachary Tim, the other day. He's a good example of a person who tried to plant himself while he was still alive.
That's right.
He was a man who had fallen in sin, and the church and his wife and everyone forgave him. It was a very open sin.
That's right.
At that moment, this man should have just kind of set himself down and got off the scene, okay?
Yeah.
Instead of him doing that and going to make reconciliation with his family the right way, his church the right way, the Most High the right way, he said, well, I'm going to continue. I don't think I need to remove myself. I'm just going to really try hard. And so because he didn't deal with the sin that was going on up in here, and he just continued on in his way, they ended up finding this man in a hotel room, dead. And he was with some prostitutes. So he never died to his flesh. But he tried to keep himself planted in that church, in that ministry, and all of this stuff in the midst of his sin. And so he essentially rotted away in his sins without ever having a chance to experience real, true spiritual death. so that he could rise.
That's right.
And so he died in shame.
That's right. See, when you look at a person, especially people that have habits, well, they have the habits because of they haven't died to their flesh.
Mm-hmm.
You see, when you think about what the scripture says, okay, it says, he that is dead is free from sin.
Mm-hmm.
You
yes.
see? He that is dead is free from sin.
Yes.
Yeah, then it says, reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto Elohim. You see? And then it says, and your members, huh? Your members, your body, huh? He says, mortify your members, right? Mm-hmm. That are upon the earth. So your eyes, your ears. See, all that stuff is spiritual. When he said, if thine eye offend thee, pluck it out. Because
mm-hmm.
it's better for the one member to be destroyed than for the whole body to be burned in hell. Well, he's not literally telling you to pluck your eye out. But he's telling you, in other words, there are things that are affecting
That's
your
right.
eye gate here
right.
that you need to turn it off. So if you can't get on the internet without something going through your mind that ain't right, then you don't need to be on the internet.
That's
if you can't watch TV, then you don't need to watch it. If you got some problems in your flesh,
right.
some problems in your mind,
right.
some problems with, then you need to turn that stuff off. Turn it off. Whatever it is that's causing you, right?
Right.
If a person, let me tell you something. If you were a smoker, right? And you have a problem. You finally gave up smoking, but it's still bothering you, right? Well, don't go visit no tobacco shops, right?
That's right.
What are you stepping up in the tobacco shop for? You need to keep far away from anywhere that sells cigarettes, right? That's how this thing works. You got to cut yourself off from these things, you see. Now, there are all types of habits that people get into. They don't understand the way to get past those things is through death.
Right.
The death of your flesh. That's
mm-hmm.
right.
Mm-hmm.
That's right. So once you die to the flesh, then it's an easy walk because you do it through the spirit. Right?
Mm-hmm.
Don't the scripture says, walk in the spirit and you won't fulfill the lust of the flesh?
That's what it says.
Because they're contrary the one to the other so that you cannot do the things that you would. So in other words, there's power against sin if you walk in the spirit. Right?
Yes.
So it's all in understanding things. Understanding what the scripture is saying and in doing your part as far as trying to die to self.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Let me explain something to you here. I want you to think about that, right? If there's ever a sin that's taking place, ever some type of anything that's dealing with sin, I guarantee you it's linked to that flesh.
Yes, it
mm-hmm.
is.
I guarantee you it's linked to the flesh.
Yes.
Okay? Now, that's why the scripture says that he came in the form of sinful flesh, likeness of
mm-hmm.
sinful flesh.
Mm-hmm.
Right? But was tempted in every point and did not commit sin.
That's right.
Okay? So we basically have to understand what this walk is and how we could live a set apart life.
Yes.
And sometimes the Most High have to take us through some suffering.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes he have to. Because he's trying to burn some things off of you, okay?
Mm-hmm.
There's some things that's you,
mm-hmm.
okay? Come on, let's be honest.
That's right.
There's some things that's you, that's right here on you right now
that's
as
right.
I speak.
That's
Those
right.
things got to die, right?
Mm-hmm.
You got to die to that stuff. Now, let's go to the scripture in Acts. This is Acts chapter 14 and verse 22. I'm going to read this one, okay? It says, confirming the souls of the disciples and exhorting them to continue in the faith, that we must through much tribulation enter into the kingdom of Yah.
Wow.
Wow.
Right.
Now I know we want to live a life of just skipping upon the beautiful grass, smelling the tulips. You know, I know we want to enjoy that kind of life, right? I know we want our little mansion on the hill, we want to go out to our little brook, you know, look at the little deer and just enjoy all of this stuff. I know we want to, right? Okay? But we're going to go through some things. The Most High has ordained it. I heard a brother say this one time in church years ago. He said, I'm just praying that the Most High take me through some tribulations. I said, I looked, I'm like, you ain't got to pray for that, brother.
They coming.
You don't have to ask him
That's
for it.
Guaranteed.
Trust me, he's looking at your soul. And he's seeing what need to be done to get you into the kingdom.
That's
and so he says, okay, this is brother such and such right here, right? Mm-hmm. Now, I need to get him into the kingdom, so you know what I'm going to do? He start calling the angels and the spirits and all kinds of get things rolling with him, okay? I need y'all to work on him. And things get to hitting them here, hitting them there, taking them here, taking them there. And after a while, person, I know what it's like, because after a while, you'll be like, oh man, what now? Huh? I've been there. I know what that's like to be going through things all the time. You basically say, what now? Can I get a break? You know? I prayed that to y'all sometimes. I've actually said that to you. Father, y'all, what now? Can I get a break from this? Father, y'all, please help me. Mm-hmm. You know, sometimes he allows things to happen to you. And also, listen to me. Sometimes he allows things to happen to you because he's trying to get a certain spirit to rise up in you.
Yes, that's right.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Now, you take a person, for instance, right? You're trying to teach a person how to fight. They don't fight. Sitting there, you say, fight. Put an opponent in front of them. Opponent standing there looking at him. And he's like, go ahead, fight the guy. And the guy looking at him, he said, no, he got his hands down. Mm-hmm. So Moses say, okay, go ahead, hit him. Mm-hmm. Bam! Mm-hmm. Oh, it's like, you gonna fight? No? Okay, hit him again. Bam, bam! You know? Bam, 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 bam! You know? And then eventually, you're gonna be like, okay, get off me, right?
Right.
Sometimes the Most High will let demons, mm-hmm. you hear what I said? Sometimes he will allow demons to come in your life.
Mm-hmm.
Isn't that scary? He will allow a demon to come in. Them angels, them shepherds will sit back and they'll say, they'll send a few, send Ick and Wick over to get him, okay? These two demons will come over there. Before you know it, that person will be sitting back and say, why? Because he's trying to get you out of, he's trying to teach you how to cast them out.
Yes.
You understand? How you going to learn how to cast out a demon if you never deal with one, right?
Mm-hmm.
Huh? You know you got the ability to cast out a devil?
Yes,
huh? He said, I give you power to tread on serpents and scorpions.
Yes,
huh?
Mm-hmm.
That nothing by any means can hurt you.
Yes, hallelujah.
Wow.
Mm-hmm.
He said, I gave you power over the devil.
Mm-hmm.
He said, I beheld Satan as lightning falling from the sky. Right?
Mm-hmm.
So basically, this is something he have to allow you to go through some things.
Mm-hmm.
And you know what? It's kind of funny. I remember when I went through that sickness years ago after I swallowed that glass and my throat was messed up.
Mm.
My stomach was messed up. And I remember when I went through that. When the Most High healed me up, I went through 5 years of at least five, it was maybe even more than five, of just where I couldn't eat certain things. And then finally, when the Most High healed me of that, I said, wow, that's all it took.
It was just faith,
and he healed it like that.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't have to go through that 5 years. That I had the faith, I could have been like that, right?
Mm-hmm.
Just like Israel didn't have to go 40 years, right?
Mm-hmm.
Faith like that, they could have been in the promised land,
mm-hmm.
right? So sometimes we just got to understand sickness can come on a person, demons, all kinds of things, and it's not that you're supposed to fall back, oh, they got me, forget it, you know? And you ain't supposed to do that. You're supposed to rise up against them, okay?
Right.
Don't give up.
Another thing, too, and this one is kind of hard for us to understand, but sometimes the Most High have to kill us in order to save us.
Mm.
And that's in the Word.
Whoa.
It's in the Word. If he wants to save you, sometimes he have to take you out of here.
Yes, he will.
Mm. Wow.
Mm-hmm.
That's something. Wow.
And it's hard to accept
that. You got scripture?
Yes.
I know what scripture. Good. You know where it's at?
I don't know where it is, but many of us do, is to turn such a one over to the devil.
Yep.
For the destruction of the flesh.
That's
that
right.
The soul might be saved.
You hear that?
Mm-hmm.
Wow. You hear that?
And so many times we look at a person when they die and we think it's judgment, or we think it's one thing or another, or that they didn't make it, that they're not with the Most High, but that even though that earthly tabernacle may be dissolved, that person is probably at rest with the Father. If he was one of the Father's children,
that's right.
He says, look, I'm going to have to kill him so I can save him. Because what if the Most High knows that if this person continued on, that this person would have lost their soul. He knows the end before the before it even starts, right?
Wow.
The Most High knows our minds. He says, I know your thoughts afar off.
Yes, he does.
And since he knows our thoughts afar off, he knows us better than we know ourselves. Yes, today we might feel strong.
Mm-hmm.
We might feel like we can walk this walk and run to the end mm-hmm. to see what it's going to be. We might feel like we can make it, but the Most High says, next year, this person's going to come up against something and it's going to turn their hearts away from me. And so with him knowing that, his love says, I'm going to have to do something right now.
Yep.
And we think that death is so horrible, but to live is Yahusha, and to die is gain. Especially for someone who may have made the wrong choice in the future. And Yah knowing that, being all-knowing, he deals with you at that moment.
Yes,
and for that, we have to say thank Hallelujah. You. We have to say thank you, Father.
Well, you know what? I know of a situation. I know of a person that this actually happened to.
Mm-hmm.
And this was a young lady years ago when I was going to this particular church. But she had a disease, and she had gotten sick. But before she got really sick, no one really knew she had the disease. She wasn't nothing but about, I'm trying to think, how old was she when she died? Probably about 14 or 15 years old, you know? But anyway, this young lady, right, she's full of the Ruach and everything. And she, when she had gotten sick and had died, the parents were just so distraught over it. And I was there, actually, in the room when she died. And the Most High instructed me to get them out of the room. So I got them out of the room because they were sitting there looking at her pass like that. And it was just... They were just having a hard time. So I got them out of the room, took them into another room that I was able to pray for them and everything, right? Now, as I was praying for them, I could sense that the Most High, that this was His will. He wanted her to go, you know? I didn't understand why. Then later He gave me a vision of her soaring in the sky with Him. Just mm-hmm. you know?
Mm-hmm.
I knew she was going to be with Him, you know? Mm-hmm. So I was like, wow, you know. But let me tell you what happened. We're at the funeral, my pastor at the time was a very spiritual man.
Mm-hmm.
What he said was so powerful because it was just like that. He said he prayed. Now, this man have laid hands on a lot of people that have gotten healed.
Mm-hmm.
A good number of people. I'm talking about healed of cancers, real healings.
Mm-hmm.
I had family members that had cancer. You know, I had an old family member. There was Ken on my father's side, Mother Hudson. They had cancer, and people knew she had gotten sick. It was at the hospital, and she ended up on the doctors that diagnosed her. They ended up dying before her, you know. She prayed, but my pastor, he wouldn't pray for her, laid hands on her, and said, do you want to live? She's like, yes, I want to live. He said, well, let's pray. He laid hands on her, and she got after that day, she got better. Before you know, she's up and out of the hospital, and the cancer was completely gone, right? So we've seen him heal a number of times, okay? But when he laid hands and went and prayed for her, he walked away and said the Most High is going to take her. And people knew, and people was like, oh my goodness, like you can't heal her, or what was going on? You know, people were really kind of bothered by it, right? But at the message, he told them that the Most High took her. It was for a reason why he took her, because he was sparing her from down the line, her life. And now who knows what actually could have happened in her life that could have caused her to come out of the way or backslide or whatever. That's right. He took her at a young age, you see. So I'm telling you right now, sometimes we don't understand these things, and I know they're hard to understand. I know it's a hard one, you know, but at the same time, we got to understand that Yah knows what He's doing.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? No one can die without Him knowing about it.
That's right. Yes, that's right.
Satan can't take anyone's life.
Right.
Now, Yahushua even said, he said, you don't take my life, I lay it down. Well, guess what? They don't take nobody's life. Yah even gives the authority for them to do it when they did. When they took Peter's life, trust me on it. If it hadn't been the will of Yah, they could have swung the sword or did anything to Peter. Nothing had happened. You understand? Mm-hmm. So we got to understand what's going on. He ordains these things, right? He mm-hmm. ordains so much in our lives. And so we just got to trust Him.
That's right.
Okay? Now, Let's go to this scripture here. This is in James, 1 James chapter 1, verse 2 and 3. Deborah, I'm going to read it. Actually, I'm going to give you a break. I'm going to let Sophia read it. Sophia, you read this. James chapter 1, verse 2 and 3.
My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience.
Okay, now did you hear that? It says, count it all joy, pretty much. Count it all joy. It's like, man, wait a minute. Man, let's go through John the Baptist for a minute, right? Now, he's in the prison, right? And you tell him, John the Baptist, just count it all joy. You know what I'm saying? You in prison, you tell, count it all joy. But they about to take my head. I know. Count it all joy. Huh? I'm struggling right now. We've been set out. Huh? We're out in the streets now. Don't have a home. We're homeless right now. Count it all joy. Wow. Isn't that something?
Yeah.
See, it's a hard one to do. But I guarantee you, you get to count it all joy. And you'll be surprised what the Most High have, what kind of reward He have for you when you're going through your trials and your tribulations. Count it all joy because it's working patience in you, right? You see, it's working patience.
I want to address a message that we received from a sister, because I know that many of you feel this way as Israelites. Because we go through, it's kind of hard to hear the message of count it all joy. I don't know if you remember, Yahoo, when I was reading the message that one sister sent, and she said, I've been praying and I've been doing all this stuff. I've been serving the Most High, and I've had to watch this one die and that one die and all these things happen. And I am convinced that I've been loving the Most High, but He hasn't been loving me back.
Yeah.
And that I'm finished with all of that.
Yeah, you hear that?
Now, that may sound horrible, but there are people who feel that way.
Yes.
And so we've been asking the Most High, how to teach us how to minister to that type of person, because this is a person who is hurting.
Yeah.
They are confused as to why they have done all of these things, and they feel unloved. And they've looked upon they said they've done things and the Most High frowned upon them, but they've had wicked people do the same thing and they've gotten blessed as a result of it.
Yeah.
Now, we do know that this is the curses, and many of us are tired of hearing, oh, it's the curses, it's the curses. We don't want to hear that anymore.
Yeah.
But you have to hear this message today, family, because that thing that you're going through, you will continue to go through it and witness these things until you get it right. Because the Most High, He has a way, He has a decree that He's already set forth.
That's right.
Okay, His word is going out of His mouth and won't return void. Israel, murmuring and complaining, they reaped from that.
That's right.
And what they reaped from that was more sadness, more pain, because the Most High did not like the murmuring and the complaining.
That's right.
Some of them died in the wilderness as a result of it. You know, more horrible things came up on them as a result of it.
As a result of it, yeah.
And so, as you face things, as we all face things, we can't shake our fist at the Most High. Okay, we cannot shake our fist at the Most High. We've got to come to terms with the fact that He is Yah, and that He can do whatever He wants. The scripture says He will have His way in the heavens above and the earth beneath. He will have His way. He created some people for destruction, family.
Yes, He did. Yes,
you see, we have to come to terms with all of that.
That's right.
We've been given this image of the Most High that is false, that He's all forgiving. He says the same Elohim that will forgive is also an Elohim of wrath.
That's right.
You have to keep that in mind. So we have to contain our anger. When we start to go through things, we have to contain it. And you ask Yah for mercy in situations. Ask Him if He can give us relief. But never allow yourself to get to the point where you are cursing Yah.
That's right.
You see how Job's wife said you need to just curse Him and die. Because things, I mean, I can't think of anyone who's went through more than Job has.
That's right. For him to lose his family like he did and everything that he had, I mean, he went through a lot.
But Job, he was a man of perfect faith.
That's right.
A man of perfect faith. And many of us don't even have one-tenth, one-thousandth of his faith.
Yeah.
You see, so We have to really strive for that family and kind of fight the urge to curse Yah, because that's essentially what we do when we say things. Now, he does tell us to come boldly before him. That's different than cursing him. When you come boldly before the Most High, you're saying, look, Father, you promised me this in your word. You promised me this, and so I'm going to hold you to that. Okay? He says, come boldly before the throne of grace, right? But you are not to curse Yah, and you are not to speak things that are untrue, because you feel like things that you're going through in your life are just too heavy to bear. It is not true that the Most High don't give a care about you. That is not true. And the enemy wants you to utter those words so that you can take them in and that you can let that rest in your belly, so you can justify walking away from Yah and living in sin.
That's right. Absolutely, absolutely. You know, it's amazing. I've listened to that person that made that that statement. I can truly say this, that I've been there.
Okay,
I've been there. I've been to a place one time. I'll never forget this. I got so angry because I was seeking the Most High for some things. I want some things to happen in my life, and I was struggling so hard. When I first received the Ruach, that first 2 years were the hardest 2 years probably of my life. And I had already been through some things before I received the Ruach. After I received the Ruach, man, and within the first year, my closest friend of mine hung himself. And I was witnessing to him and everything, studied witnessing to him, trying to tell him about the Most High, and he just hung himself. And I was like, oh man, that hit me hard, you know? He's my closest friend, you know? And then I went through this struggle financially, trying to get a job, can't get a job, struggling. Here I was in the Word, walking upright before the Most High, keeping His Word, meditating. I was doing some of everything, and just nothing would happen. I would always get doors closed on me. And one where I got so frustrated, so I grabbed my Bible and I ripped it and threw it under my bed. I was like, you don't hold your word. And I was just angry, you know. I sure did. I get that angry. And I'll never forget, I was sitting there on the bed and I was just angry. And I was like, couldn't get an answer from him. And I was sitting there, I was like, I'm not going to pray anymore. I'm not going to do this. I had even had other thoughts. I'm not going to say, because I got kids in here, you know. But I had other thoughts going through my mind. And I remember sitting there on the bed like this, just angry. And then I heard a quiet voice say, predestination.
Look at that.
And I was like, I don't want to hear that, you know. And he said it again, predestination. And I was like, I don't want to hear that, right? Then he said it again. This time he said, you are predestinated.
Wow.
I was like, what? He said, you are predestinated. I said, I'm predestinated. I said, well, how am I predestinated? I said, because it looked like ain't nothing going right for me, you know? It looked like this, what? I'm predestined. Predestinated to what? The instruction, you know? And so I was feeling a sense of like what, you know? But when he said that, it turned something on in me. And I said, well, let me see what he's talking about. So I started looking in the Word, and a new revelation came forth that was so powerful, this revelation. Then I understood why I had to go through what I went through. You know? See, the scripture says the steps of the righteous man is ordered by Yah.
Yes,
that though he may fall, what?
Yes.
The fall is ordered?
Yes.
Did you hear that?
Yes.
Though he may fall, he will not be utterly cast down.
That's right.
So he's walking and he may stumble and fall. Oh, all of that is ordered by Yah. You see? That's right. So, other words, when you fall and everything, get back up. Don't think that it's for your destruction. It's for you to get back up. All babies fall when they start to walk, don't they? I never seen a baby before that start walking that don't fall a few times, right? They all fall. All of us are fit. Now, I know when some of you out here probably saying, they said, look here, when I was a baby dude, I stood up and started walking. I ain't never fail. You know? But you know you have fallen before, right? You know you have, right? And so, when we look and we see our brethren falling from here and there, and they're not getting it right. They ain't getting it right. They just leave them alone. Watch them. If they're Yah's, I guarantee you, Yah's going to whip them in shape. I guarantee you. If they're not Yah's, he says, what? Then you're a bastard. If you be without chastisement, then you are a bastard. You see? So if they doing all this hell out there and ain't nothing happening to them, then I would get away from that person. Mm-hmm. I would get far away from him.
Well, there are a number of people wanting you to elaborate more on predestination, which I think that's a good idea because a lot of people don't understand what it means to be predestined or predetermined.
Right. Okay, well, let's look at it like this here, okay? I want you to think about this. Okay. Now, in order for Yah to be who he say he is, right? Mm-hmm. He has certain attributes, right? And those attributes go like this here. He's omniscient. He's omnipotent, omnipotent, omniscient, and what's the other one?
All-knowing.
All-knowing, that's omniscient.
The same reason why he knows your thoughts.
That's right, that's right. And he's immutable, okay? These are all his characteristics, right? Now, that simply means this here, okay? 1,000 years ago, before you were born, he knew that you were going to be born. Matter of fact, before Adam was created, he knew that one day you were going to be born. Mm-hmm. Okay? So the day he created Adam, he ordained that you would come to life too, because he knew the future of Adam and his seed. Mm-hmm. Okay? So, him just knowing it, the future, and creating Adam anyway proves that he predestinated all things. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Here, get this too, family. The scripture says that he was the lamb slain before the foundation of the earth.
That's right.
So, all of you who say, well, it was Eve's fault. Okay. Let's take a look at that. That's if he was the lamb slain before the foundation of the
Eve
earth.
Even sinned.
Right.
Adam even sinned. He was considered the lamb slain for the sins of people that wasn't even created yet.
That's right.
See, that's
so
deep.
Yeah, you're just playing out the part that you've been given.
That's right.
Eve was playing out her part too.
That's right. She's playing out her part.
Playing out his part.
Yes. Same, playing out his part. Yeah, all of them
every
are created for
us.
Yah. That's right. Mm-hmm. To that's bring about, what's his purpose though? Bring about his glory.
Yes.
You see, Yah sat there and he said, okay, I need to. I need to show
my power.
Mm-hmm. Okay? Now, how is somebody going to show my power if I don't create certain things to show my power in, right? Mm-hmm. I got to have an opposition, right? If I don't have an opposition, you ain't going to know how powerful I am.
Mm-hmm.
So I got to create an opposition that's going to come up so you can see how horrible it is. And so when I, damn, do this, I crush it, wham, you know? Mm-hmm. Then what happens? You say, wow, Yah is powerful.
Yes.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
So then he creates these things to bring about certain things, right? So that he can show his glory. It's all to show his glory. That's why the scripture says, what if Yah willing to show his wrath? Now, he wants to manifest his wrath too.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that's kind of scary because he's saying, I want to manifest my wrath. So in order to manifest my wrath, I need a vessel of wrath.
Mm-hmm.
Just fit it to destruction so that I can demonstrate how angry I can get. Now, some of you will sit there and say, oh, this is horrible. Yes, it is. That's right. They call it the decretum horrible. That's right. That's Latin for the horrible decree. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
That's what that means. It's a horrible decree. Mm-hmm. Okay? Somebody had to be Judas, right?
Yes.
Scripture says better that he wasn't even born.
Mm.
You see? So, what we got to understand is that now, let's look at you, for instance, okay? Now, your life is predestinated. You hear me?
Yes.
And he knows everything that's going to happen in your life from here on.
Mm-hmm.
Now, since he knows it, all of this, I discovered that he wants you to know it, too.
Mm-hmm.
He wants you to know what? The future.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you can understand the future, then you won't make so many mistakes.
That's right.
You'll go in the right direction. Isn't that something?
Mm-hmm.
Can you imagine if Yah could tell you, next week you're going to do this, don't do it.
Mm.
Or next week you're not going to do this, but you really need to do this. Mm-hmm. Right? Can you imagine what difference that will make in your life? Right? But he does know all things. Mm-hmm. So that's why we are supposed to acknowledge him in all our ways, mm-hmm. so that he can direct our path. Yes. Right? Because he knows the future. Mm-hmm. Okay? So now, in our life, we make a substantial amount of mistakes, falls, and all these things. And I discovered these things were ordained to be in our life so that we can grow and get closer to him and learn things and just grow. Even prayer, he has predestinated that certain things won't happen until you pray for them. Yep. There are some blessings that he got lined up for you, right? And there's a prayer that come before that blessing. You get what I'm saying? There's a prayer right there. And so if you don't pray, that blessing gonna stay right here. Mm-hmm. So he has ordained to give you knowledge to, okay, I need to show him this so he'll pray for this. And once he get to praying for it, then all of a sudden, there's the blessing.
Yes.
Because he ordained certain things to come through prayer. Mm. He said, ask and it shall be given. So what? Right. If you don't ask, you ain't gonna get? That's because he ordained it to come through you asking.
Yes.
That's right. You see?
That's why one thing that I've said to people before, when I was talking about the ways of the Most High and everything, is that I consider everything that exists right now, the universe and all the things that have happened in history and all the things that are going to happen in the future, to be almost like Yah's big blockbuster movie store. And we're all playing our part in it.
Yeah.
And that's why the scripture says he made everything for his own pleasure.
You hear that? Yes. He made everything for his own everything?
Mm-hmm.
For his own pleasure?
Big
yeah.
Movie script.
Yeah, everything. Isn't that something?
Mm-hmm.
Everything. I bet Satan don't know what to do. I bet when he was required to just go up into the kingdom, you know, he had to show up too. The angels all showing up, right, having a meeting, and Satan go walking down here to go to this meeting, you know. But he sat there with the Most High, like in the time of Job, it talks about that. I bet he sat there in the meeting, and y'all said, have you looked over at Satan like this? Probably said, have you considered my servant Job? Mm-hmm. Satan was sitting there, yeah, you know I've considered him, but you got this hedge about it, I can't get to him. And y'all looking down at Job, he said, well, I tell you what, I'm going to remove that hedge, and he won't curse me. Satan said, yes, he will curse you. Can you imagine? They were up in heaven having a conversation about him.
Satan up there looking at y'all like, you know good and well what you're doing. Mm-hmm. And stuff. Probably sitting there all annoyed.
He was probably convinced, though, that because of his arrogance, he said, I bet I can get him.
I know I can get him.
That's the same reason why he felt like he could have exalted his throne above the stars.
Yeah.
That's why.
Because he's thinking of the impossible.
Yeah. I bet when he goes up there, I bet he sits there because he hasn't been, listen to what I say here. He hasn't been exiled, or shall I say, kicked out of heaven yet. You want to see it? That part in Revelation chapter 12 has not taken place yet. Okay? That war that goes on in heaven, that hasn't taken place yet. So he can still travel to and fro to heaven. Okay? When that war takes place, that's when he get kicked out. And then the scripture proceeds and says what? That his place was not found in heaven anymore after that. Okay, because of this war that he goes up there and tries to start. So now I bet you when Satan does have to go up there, when he does go up there before Yah, I bet you all the time he's sitting there thinking to himself, I know I can overthrow him. I know I can. Yah sitting over there looking at him like you really think you can overthrow me.
But dude, you can't even see me.
Yeah, you can't even see me. Exactly. And he probably thought he had the Messiah.
Mm-hmm.
He really thought he had the Messiah, you know.
Mm-hmm.
When you read the Gospel of Nicodemus? Yeah, he thought he really had him. Then they say, is he the one? The one that took Lazarus from me? If this is the one, then don't send him down here, you know, because he going to come down here and change things, you know, but it's too late. You know, he got down there and changed things, you see.
Talking about when Satan was talking to Apollyon?
Yeah, he's talking to Apollyon, right. He's talking to, yeah, that's right. The I forget what scripture
Angel
called
Angel of the Bottomless Pit.
Yeah, I don't know if it called him Apollyon in the book of Nicodemus, right?
Mm-hmm.
So basically, these are the kind of things that's going on. So, you know, that is but see, this is it's so much to what we're talking about. And that's why I tell everybody, hey, do a lot of studying on some of these things that we talk about. Research them for yourself, because that learning about predestination was a huge, it made a huge change in my life at that time. At that time, I knew then that no matter what I went through, I was going to make it through it. And that's something, that's what it did for me. I knew no matter what it was I went through, that I was going to get back up on my feet and make it through it. That I knew it wasn't the end of me. I knew it wasn't. I said, no, I'm going to get through this too. You know, each time I went through something bad, I would sit there, no matter what it was. I could have been sick. It could have been somebody dying. It could have been this. And most of them always tell me, you're going to get through this too. You know, you're going to get through this too. And I would always do what I would call transcend time. Mm-hmm. I would sit there in the suffering that I was going through, and I would say, that's okay. And I would look ahead months later and say, a few months from now, I'm going to look back on this day, and I'm going to be past it. And this pain that I'm feeling is going to be gone. This sickness that I'm going through is going to be gone. It's going to be finished. I'm going to look back on this thing. It's going to be a thing of the past.
That's right.
And sure enough, that's how I get through it, by looking beyond.
That's
just
right.
Like Scripture said, who for the joy that was set before him, he did what? Endured the stake, despising the shame, and it sat where? At the right hand.
Hallelujah.
That's right. That's what we got. We, for the joy that's set before us, looking unto who? Yahushua is who? The author and the finisher of our faith. So wait a minute. He's the author of your faith? Oh, whoa, whoa. Did you even hear that?
Right.
So you mean to tell me David, when David didn't have that much faith, he said, okay, send the bear over there.
That's right.
He fought the bear. He said, okay, his faith is getting stronger. Now send the lion. Fought the lion. Okay, now Goliath.
Oh.
Right? He sat there and he worked on David's faith.
Yes.
He's the author, so he's writing things in your life.
Yes.
Right? He's writing things in your life that's going to happen, that he's trying to build your faith.
Yes. Hallelujah.
Through your trials and your tribulation.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's why this scripture here is so important. Let's go to 1 Peter chapter 4. First Peter chapter 4. And this is verse 12. Deborah, you can read it.
1 Peter chapter 4, verses 12 reads as follows. Beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial which is to try you as though some strange thing happened unto you.
Read 13 also.
But rejoice, inasmuch as ye are partakers of HaMashiach's suffering, that when his glory shall be revealed, ye may be glad also with exceeding joy.
Wow, did you hear that? Yeah.
I want to read 14 too.
Go ahead.
It says, if you be reproached for the name of HaMashiach, happy are you, for the Ruach Yahuwah of glory rest upon you. On their part he is evil spoken of, while on your part he is glorified.
Wow.
We have become a reproach
and
as a people before all nations.
That's right. That's
for
right.
This very reason right here. It had to happen. It had to take place. He said, they hated me. They're going to hate you too.
That's right.
True.
We have to go through all of this. So when he glorifies us, it has to be a stark contrast between
that's
the
right.
two. We have to be at rock bottom.
Wow.
That's right.
Because if we were living a life that was kind of sparkly, when he glorifies us, he's saying, well, it's not too much different than what they already had.
That's right.
So he had to make us the base people.
That's
so that
right.
when he elevates us,
that's right.
those who used to look down upon us,
yeah.
they're going to be amazed. They're going to look upon
right.
us
yep.
and say, wow.
Wow.
Look at the
him.
Glory that has been revealed
that's
in this
right.
people that were once a base
yeah.
people.
That's right.
That's right.
That's right. Now, you know what's amazing here? I like this part. It says, on their part, he is evil spoken of. But on your part, he is glorified. See, people will look at what you're going through, and they'll be like, oh, man, he must have did something wrong. Man, he must be wicked. He must be whatever, because the person going through something, right? You see, we get confused. We think that if a sickness come upon a person, that sickness, he must have did something wrong, right? He must have did something wrong. Well, not necessarily. That person could just be going through a trial. Maybe something that he don't understand. And the Most High may want to even heal him. The sickness could be on him so he can get healed.
Right.
You just never know. So, you know, we just don't understand things. But he says here that is evil spoken of, but on your part, he is glorified. So they don't see the glory that Yah is working in that person. Mm-hmm. They may be sick. They may be going through something. You see? Mm-hmm. And he says, don't think it's strange. Mm-hmm. It, don't think of it like a strange thing because you're going through some crazy stuff. Mm-hmm. I mean, I've been through a lot of stuff in my lifetime, a lot of crazy stuff. You know, I've been through it, okay? And so I've learned that, you know, we just need to understand how to count it all joy and look beyond what you're going through. Mm-hmm. You understand? So we're going to take a moment. We're going to answer some questions. We want to answer some questions. So if anyone have any questions, feel free to speak them or type them, should I say. And if any of you here have any questions also. Hopefully by next week we will be able to have something else that we're going to be doing. Mm-hmm. We're going to try to do it, have it ready by next weekend. But I may have to send out a blast to everyone or something to let them know how we're going to be doing things different so that we don't have to deal with this bad reception as far as the internet is concerned.
Okay, there's a question. Are we going to be doing a lesson on the serpent's seed? Well, part of White It Out 6 is covering that, so I guess in a sense that will be a lesson, but it's going to be within that documentary.
Okay, can a person who have sold their soul to Satan pray that the Most High take it back, or is that predestinated in the person's life? It's a good one.
That's a good question.
Well, I'm going to say this to you, okay? Usually a person that have sold their soul is a person that have been probably spit out by Yah.
Yeah, reprobate.
They're reprobate, okay?
In other words, they would never even seek to repent.
To repent.
That's why
come
one
back.
Person
that's right.
That I like to mention is Chris Rock. Because when you look at his TV series, Everybody Hates Chris, even in the intro theme, he jokingly says, even the clouds hate Chris. So it's obvious that he had a lot of curses in his life that a Hebrew Israelite would experience. But then it's like once he sells his soul and then gets famous and becomes Chris Rock, now everything seems to be going for him.
Yeah.
He's been spit out.
Yeah. You see. And usually a person that spit out, like we said, they don't want to come back.
Yeah.
They sold their soul, you know.
Many of them become atheists.
Yeah.
I've seen a number of high-profile black celebrities who say they don't believe at all. They're atheists. So,
that's right.
It's highly doubtful that they would even seek repentance.
Yeah, that's right.
And if there is a person who is seeking repentance, they probably weren't spit out. They probably just got into a lifestyle but never really sold their soul. I don't believe that everyone who has sang a song or anything like that or gotten at a certain point in their life has sold their soul. But some of them very clearly have.
Yeah.
And there are certain things I think they have to go through to actually sell their soul.
Yeah.
I definitely think it's worth research to determine how far you must take it. Because there has even been talk of those who have joined sorority groups and made pledges within those that may have sold their souls, and they're not even rich and famous. And so...
Well, the scripture makes it clear, too, that he turns them over to a reprobate mind.
Mm-hmm.
So a reprobate mind, they stuck. Esau's reprobate, you know?
The determining factor, yeah.
That's why it's talked about Esau. Say, though he sought it carefully with tears, he could not find repentance in his heart.
It was hid from him.
He was crying, but at the same time, he couldn't stop doing what he was doing.
Yeah.
You know, that's like a person crying, no, I hate this cream in this thing here. I hate it. And he started getting it, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's how Esau was, you see. He hated that he was going through what he was going through, but he couldn't stop being wicked.
Yeah.
You see, he couldn't turn it off.
Even if he has moments of time to where he's doing well,
yeah,
all of a sudden, he changes his mind. I'll give you a good example of what I'm talking about, family. There have been Gentiles who have accepted the truth, or so they say, in believing who we are and who the Most High is and all of that. But then they get to a certain point to where they just can't take it anymore. And they retract all of that. They say, I don't believe that stuff. That's a bunch of lies. I don't even believe there is a God.
That's right.
It's like they get to that point, even though they may have started off strong and you're trusting that they've been grafted in properly, and then all of a sudden they just throw it all away. And so that kind of reminds me of what the scripture says about Esau, even though he sought it carefully with tears, because some of them cry out.
Yeah.
But then they get to that point where they just throw the truth completely out because the Most High won't allow them to grab hold of it.
That's right. Absolutely.
Okay, another question. A couple of people asked the same question. If you are baptized in the wrong name, do you have to be rebaptized once you come into the truth?
Absolutely.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. You should be rebaptized once you come into the truth. Now, someone says here.
Okay. I missed that one. Go ahead and speak up.
You can lend your soul to. Oh, that's not a question. Somebody just answered somebody else's question.
Okay. There's a brother who says he lives in Detroit, and he wants to know, is there any true believers around in Detroit? Well, yes, there are. We went to one of the gatherings there last year. No, I'm sorry, it was this year.
Last summer.
Yeah, one more day before next year. But Chosen Seed Ministries, they are gathering, is it every July or September?
August.
August, okay. They gather every August. There are other groups as well.
Mm-hmm.
We don't know of any particular source that you can go to and find these ministries, but a lot of people get connected on Facebook, and you can possibly see what type of events they're going to have. But I do know that they have an event every year in August. And Chosen Seed.
Yes. I just want to encourage everyone, really investigate when you decide to fellowship with others. There's a lot of doctrinal changes.
Mm-hmm.
There are a lot of people that are now anti-Messiah. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I know a lot of times we're excited about fellowshipping,
mm-hmm.
but there's just too many things going on, you know, and out of our emotional need to want to connect,
mm-hmm.
we jumped in, and then we realize later that there's, you know, wickedness going on, severe doctrinal issues going on. So really test the spirit of these groups and people.
Be careful
before you jump in and grab a hold to fellowships, congregations, and ministries.
That's right.
Absolutely.
Be careful.
Excellent advice.
That's right.
Excellent advice. Even though you want the fellowship, because there are fellowships all over the country, actually. And you go to these fellowships because you want to be around the brethren. But you want to understand, too, what they believe. Just because you go to a fellowship doesn't mean that you have to gravitate to their teachings or what they believe. Because there are people who go to some of these fellowships and they don't believe the same things, you see. We fellowship with people before who don't have the same beliefs that we have. But we like to separate fellowship from teaching. It's very important. Like the sister said, their teaching may not be something that you want to grab hold of. So if we decide to go to an event that may be in this state or that state or wherever it may be, whether it's where you are now, it doesn't mean that you have to hold to whatever it is they may teach. We encourage everyone, I mean, even as it relates to our teachings, you need to know the Most High for yourself. Study to show yourself approved, because many of you have told us that you don't agree with everything we say, which is perfectly fine.
That's right.
That's perfectly fine with us, you know. But there are some things where we do draw the line as far as those who reject Messiah. That's a deal breaker.
Yeah, sure is.
Yes, yes. If you don't believe in the Messiah, or you're denying the power, the scripture actually that instructs us, it says, that many would have a form of godliness but deny the power thereof, and it says from such turn away
from them. That's right.
And that's one of those things that we find it hard to do. We think it's actually wrong to turn away from people. We were instructed to do that.
Yeah, matter of fact, the scripture tells you not to eat with a fornicator.
That's right.
So if this person got some problems fornicating or whatever, and you bring this brother around you ain't supposed to do that. He ain't supposed to be in your congregation. You're supposed to turn him over to Satan. Mm-hmm. You know, because he got that flesh thing going on. Get him out of the midst of you. Mm-hmm. For you know, you have a whole house full of fornicators.
Yes, you will.
Mm-hmm. You know, that's a spirit.
Yes.
Now, someone asked this question. I want to address this question. It says, how do you know if a demonic spirit or spirits is in or around one of your children? Okay. Well, you got to understand there's two types of spirit. You have satanic spirits that are actually demons, okay? These things have personalities,
mm-hmm.
okay? And then you have spirits, okay? Which aren't, they don't have personalities, okay?
Mm-hmm.
There are ways that a person can pick up, mm-hmm. for instance. One child could have you have a child that has an attitude, a bad attitude, real bad attitude, always frowning, always upset or whatever, right? And that child could get around another kid, and before you know it, that other kid would be acting the same
mm-hmm.
way.
Mm-hmm.
Those are spirits they're picking up, okay? It's not demonic, as in a satanic demon, but it's a spirit that they're picking. It's like a way that they can pick up, they rub off. That's why
mm-hmm.
public schools are dangerous, because kids tote around all types of spirits, and they pass them around, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Like you can have a boy can have a feminine spirit,
mm-hmm.
okay?
Mm-hmm.
Well, he acts feminine. Now, he could have been raised around more girls or whatever and have feminine spirit, and that thing can be picked up from somebody else, you see? And so, but now, satanic spirits are a little different.
Mm-hmm.
Satanic spirits are personalities. Okay, you hear what I said?
Mm-hmm.
So the way you could tell if they're around your child or not is by personality changes.
Mm-hmm.
If they have these weird personalities, or you start to see some weird, mm-hmm. weird things going on, and they have conversations and they're seeing things. Talking about, oh, there's a lady in the room in there and all of that kind of stuff. Then that child may be dealing with something satanic.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and we've seen that happen before on some kids.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, well this one family's kids. They had some serious, and there's no one you all know, no
mm-hmm.
one that fellowship with us now to even know that we're on air. So I don't want none of y'all thinking, well, you talking about me and my kids? No, I'm not, okay?
Hopefully.
Yeah, hopefully not. Exactly. But this family, they had some serious issues, and these poor kids, and it's because the mother had read that album cover backwards,
Bone Thugs and Harmony,
and she read that backwards. It was backwards on the cover. She put it in the mirror and she read it, and it's actually reading a curse into your life. In her life, she had some stuff going on.
They were being visited by demons, and they were having actual things happening.
Yeah.
Things happening, the demons were actually manifesting in their presence, okay?
Doing things, getting mm-hmm. in them, and all kinds of stuff. They were seeing these spirits.
Torturing one of the little boys as well.
Yeah, torturing this one little boy,
mm-hmm.
so.
One thing I wanted to say, too, about demons. Demons are kind of tricky, especially those that possess people, okay? Not just those who mess around with kids in their dreams and torturing them like they were doing this little boy. He was screaming and afraid, right? But demons are kind of tricky. Demons can get in people, and they can be, yes, they can hide in people, and they can be educated.
They'll be so dormant in a person, they'll be sitting there in a person like this, and they'll be like, oh, I don't think nobody see me.
Mm-hmm. They can sit up in the church, and they're not, look at Beyonce. She's a good example of a person who has demons in her. Okay,
yeah.
Not being influenced by demons, but actually having demons that reside in her. And so we always think that demons are going to manifest themselves in a person in a violent way. They're not always violent.
Yeah.
They become violent when they're being cast out.
Yeah, that's when they get
That's when they become violent. And so it's very important that we have to have spiritual eyes to be able to see and discern if a person does have demons.
Yeah.
One thing I wanted to say about that, too, is it's interesting thinking about the Book of Enoch.
Mm-hmm.
How you had different types of angels, and so therefore you would have probably different types of demons that would have came forth from their offspring.
That's right.
So, like, the son of Sam would have probably been a murderer, as evidenced by the guy that went forth killing all those people. And then when you look at the folklore about the Joker and all the stuff that he has done, but then you got other fallen angel spirits that people get that are more so intelligent, and they might be trying to get their people that they're possessing to create a certain invention or something like
that's
that.
That's right. Mm-hmm. Like Sasha Fierce, the demon that's in her. The demon Sasha Fierce was probably a person at one time that was on this earth that was into dancing and all of that kind of stuff, mm-hmm. entertainment, right? Mm-hmm. And so it got in, so it is getting in Beyonce because it's like, hey, I want to live my life out. This is what I did. And so, hey, you let me live in you, and I'll dance around and do these things, and we'll both benefit from it. So that ain't a demon that's actually trying to kill her or nothing, you know? Mm-hmm. It's just saying, hey, we can share this body.
It sounds creepy. But that's what it's like.
Yeah, we can share this body, you know? I'll be good to you. I'll get you riches and everything. Mm-hmm. And so the people actually make agreements with demons all the time. Mm-hmm. They make covenants with them, you know?
How do you think sit back. Inventions,
that's right.
Atomic bomb and all that kind of stuff.
That's right.
Fruition.
That's right. Them demons ain't all wild and crazy, and some of these people, they be very intelligent. You sit there and look at them, they'll talk to you very intelligently. Mm-hmm. You see, and they sitting up with a whole host of demons in them, right? Mm-hmm. But try to cast them out, you're going to see a whole different look.
Yes.
You're going to see a whole different thing go down when you try to cast them out, right? Mm-hmm. You know, that's Sasha Fierce, boy. You try to throw that demon out of her and... You.
That body that it dwells in is going to react.
It
violently.
Will react because the thing, the entity in her is trying to stay. He doesn't want to be sent out.
That's right.
And they know that we have the authority to do that. And so there is going to act out trying to fight to stay.
That's right.
And if she doesn't want it out, you're in trouble because she has to... You know, you're trying to cast. Yeah, it's not like you can just go around casting out demons out of people that are like, I have this agreement and I want this. So you're saying, I'm going to take it out of you. And they're like, no, you're not.
That's
right.
Wisdom has to come into that. And so I just warn people who try to operate, and I'm going to cast out demons. That's a whole other realm.
Yeah, it doesn't work like that. Everyone can't do it.
Yeah, somebody mentioned about Nicki Minaj and her demon is called Roman. Roman.
That's just one of them.
She
talks about it openly.
Wow.
She talks about it openly. So, and just a personal testimony, just so people, you know, you think you talk about celebrities or, you know, the lifestyle that I had before I came to Yah that I turned away from. I remember, you know, and I think the brother was talking about it earlier when he talks about. You know, you have to go through this battle. You know, my husband and I, we were very prosperous according to the world before we came to the Most High. So when we decided to leave that lifestyle and the spirits that were allowing us to be able to do what we did, you know, years later, like maybe 3 or 4 or 5 years in, you know, the evil one just came to me and said, look, you know, you remember how good you had it, you know, make this agreement with me and where you are now, I will make sure that you're able to have what you had. So I could have made that agreement. I could have said, you know what, let's whatever. So it's not this spooky thing. It's just simply making an agreement with the evil one and saying, yes, let's partner together. Yeah. You know, I'm going to allow you to lead me so that I can get this reward. So, you know, Beyonce's on that big level, but even for us, we can make agreements. All
that's
we
right.
have to do is say
that's
yes.
Right.
That's it. And they're like, I will make this happen for you.
Yep.
And they can make it happen for you because they made it happen for me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like the scripture says, whoever you yield yourself, your members to, that's whose servant you are. So if you yield your members as instruments of unrighteousness, that's whose servant you are.
Yeah.
You know, whether it's making a deal with the devil or a deal with the Most High.
That's
right. You have to choose.
You have to choose. Mm-hmm. It reminds me of the story of that guy who, what was that guy about the lottery or something? He said, if you get the lottery, I'll preach this wicked doctrine if you let me hit the lottery.
Mm-hmm.
And then he hit the lottery and he went out and started preaching this evil doctrine.
Mm-hmm.
That's something.
Yep.
You see, so he said, yeah, we give you that money. You know, but you're going to do what we want? He said, yeah, I do what y'all want. You know, okay, well, here you go.
And these demons know, too, that he's not going to back out of it.
Yeah.
You know, he knows he's not going to back out of it. So that's why he goes ahead and let him win the lottery. And he goes about to preach his wicked doctrines.
Yeah.
Okay, we have another question here. Are public schools part of the strong delusion? Absolutely. Because they have what? They're actually teaching our children doctrines of devils.
That's right. Doctrines of devils. That's right.
We think that doctrines of devils only come through the Christian church. No. No, the public school is also a part of that same thing. They have so many untruths that they teach. And now what they're trying to do, they are they've taken out prayer, first of all, but they're trying to make it so your children are totally desensitized to homosexuality and even Baphomet. Baphomet has been coming becoming more and more popular. Mm-hmm. Even within public buildings, public institutions, they're celebrating, making statues, and they're saying, look, this is who we want to pray to in the city council meeting.
Yeah.
Why do we always have to pray to God? We want to pray to Satan. We want to pray to Baphomet. I mean, they're just starting to come just
they come
out
straight
with
out with it now.
It's no longer being hidden, mm-hmm. you see. And so, yes, I would definitely say the public school is the beginning of the wickedness right alongside the church.
Yeah.
Okay? When you have those two together, you know, they say separation of church and state, whatever. To me, they are just as joined in keeping us separated from the Most High. They wanted to create this illusion that the state is going to stay out of the church's business, right? When really the church is in bed with the state, with the government. And this is why it was so easy to deceive a lot of people, because we think this is something holy, but really it never was holy. Now their true agenda is being revealed. And that was to separate families,
yeah.
to indoctrinate you with homosexuality and sexual lewdness, and to promote serving and worshiping and praying to false gods.
Absolutely.
And so much more. Distortion of history. All of this comes through the public school, as some call it, the public food system. And so this is how they've been able to delude us. You know, this is part of the strong delusion. So that is a yes to your question. Public school is definitely a part of that. And we would say to anyone who has children in the public school, do everything that you can to get them out. We call it a rescuing. Rescue them from the public school. Anyone who is in the Christian church, you need to be rescued from that as well, because your life is in danger, literally. Do we have any other questions? This question says, what should we do to restore the Ten Commandments back to the school system to get our kids back on the right foot?
We need to keep them out of school. Get them out of school. Get them out of school.
They try to accept the Church of Satan classes into school now, from an article that I saw a few months ago.
You hear that?
Allowing the Church of Satan to teach kids.
You know, the thing is, you got to understand who's teaching your kids. So what if they got the Ten Commandments sitting there? They can have it written on the wall there in the classroom, but they're going to still teach lies to your kids. You know what I'm saying? So your kids just need to come out
here. You send your kids to church to be taught. They got the Ten Commandments right there, and your kids are still jacked up.
Yeah, they still getting taught lies, so that's right.
So I hope you got that one. I want to elaborate a little bit on that too. we are not going to do anything to try to get the Ten Commandments restored, because think about it. Even when they were praying and doing all of this other kind of stuff, they were still teaching damnable doctrine.
Yeah, and lies.
Okay, and they are still separating you from Yah. They're still separating families. So it's like the prayer never really did anything to begin with.
That's right.
And so we shouldn't try to restore anything within a wicked system, period. Our restoration is back to the Most High. That's what we should try to restore ourselves back to and get our children from under their care. We're not Muslim, but I agree with Malcolm X when he said, only a fool would send his children to their enemies to be taught.
Yeah.
I agree with him on that statement. And I'm not calling anyone a fool. I'm just making a quote because I went to the public school, okay, and some of my older children attended. Okay, but I agree with what he said. Only a fool would do that. These people have declared themselves our enemy just through the things they teach. They never have to say any mean words to us again. But the fact that they are distorting history and teaching lies and all of this kind of stuff, that's enough for us to remove our children from such a hostile environment. I believe the public school system is a hostile environment for our children.
Now I want to shine some light on something too, because me and Brother Kiefer was talking about this. Now, I want you to think about this, right? Mm-hmm. Your kid's in a public food system, right? Okay. And some emergency takes place outside of the school. What do you think they're going to do? They're going to shut that school down, and those kids are not going to be accessible by you. Okay? Right. When the stuff goes crazy, belly up, when the dollar crash, when all these crazy things that we see that could happen any day, if your kid is in school, that's the first place they're going to lock down.
Absolutely.
And you won't be able to get your kids. Now, you ask yourself, do you want your kids in that situation? Where they'll lock down your kids and cart them off to some FEMA camp or something?
And I'm an educator. I teach in the schools right now, and that is absolutely true. We have certain drills that we go through, and it's like we're teaching the children, we're keeping you safe. And because my eyes are open, I see what they're doing. And it's true. That is not a safe place. And they are training your children to go into this, what do you say? You know, they're telling them, you know, in case there's a fire, in case someone comes in to shoot. But the drill I can see through. It's not about that.
Yeah.
It is not a safe place. And you are, they, it is set up so that you're separated from your children.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's that. I'm in it, I teach in it, and I see it.
Mm-hmm.
You hear that?
Well, someone asked about the charter schools. They're no different.
I've taught in those too.
Yes, they're no different.
They're no different.
Yes.
They're no different.
Yes. You're still in the care of someone else. The scripture tells us to train up our children in the way that they should go. It never told us to send our children to Babylon to be taught. Can you imagine if Yahushua HaMashiach was sent to the Romans to be taught?
Right.
That's not how it worked.
It sounded even crazy, didn't it?
Yes. And it don't let homeschool intimidate you. We've been given a system and a method of doing it. But I like my sister's method, and her children turned out wonderful. Sister Alicia here, she used unschooling method, and her children turned out wonderful. And so we want to use the system, and we believe that they are more capable than we are to teach our children. And that's because slavery did something to us. We put them above us even after being delivered from slavery. Of course, in a sense, we're still enslaved, but we have freedom now to take our children and teach them ourselves, but we are opting out of that because we feel more confident in having someone else to do it.
Yeah.
We feel that they are going to get more by going to these institutions, and they're simply not going to get more. They're just going to get what they want them to have. But what we need to do is educate our children on the things that really matter in this world, things moving forward. How can they survive in this present world? Okay. They're learning things, in my opinion, that have absolutely no bearing on their lives whatsoever. Most of our children don't understand or know the benefits of taking care of livestock, raising or growing your own food, carpentry, electrical. I mean, things that are going to be beneficial in their lives, plumbing, herbs.
Mm-hmm.
Wouldn't you want to know how to treat yourself without a medical institution subjecting you to their poisons? Now, if they had things like that in the public school, then maybe our mindsets would be different, but they're actually not helping our children. Even with their Common Core, they're giving you alternative ways of doing math, and which is confusing to children.
Yeah.
It is absolutely horrible what they're doing to children, where they're taking something as simple as 2 + 2 and they're making it so difficult to arrive at an answer.
Yeah.
Why confuse children like that?
So they won't learn. And there's not a when I'm in the classroom, I'm not doing a lot of teaching. I'm managing behaviors because there's so much dysfunction.
Yeah, you hear that?
So I'm not even teaching. I'm babysitting, or I'm writing up slips to send them to the peak room or to the behavior or to the principal. You know, you think, even for those who say, well, I want my children to learn. I have taught in different schools. I'm not going to give the area. It doesn't matter where you are. Your children are simply not learning. I don't teach. I manage behaviors, give out a few worksheets, and wait for the bell to ring so they can go. And many of the teachers do as well. Very little learning. It's a lot of repetition.
Wow.
Sit down. It is for those of you who believe in the Most High Yah, and if you truly want your children educated, get them out of the system. They're not learning.
You know what was funny? This is I don't know if any of you remember the movie Kindergarten Cop. Remember the one scene when them kids drove him so mad he ran out to the trunk and he looked and he saw a gun there and he was like,
and it's true.
He was like, no, you can't go in there with this. But them kids hit him like that. He looked over at the gun like, the kids are hostile. I got, you know. But it was, he did get the gun. He took a ferret in there or whatever, you know, to calm him down. But it's like, I can imagine that it's like that. This one sister said, this is Nicole. She says, I am a single mom. My kids must attend public school. I'm not married or dating. How can I overcome these things? I can't afford to homeschool. Okay. Yeah, you can't afford not to. Here's the deal. I understand what's going on, okay? Here's the deal, okay? First of all, let's look at your situation. You're a single mother, right? Now, I understand you probably work a job, okay? And during the time that you're working a job, you no doubt probably have to have a babysitter, or your kids are in school as you're working at the same time that you're working. I don't know what your situation is, but you really need to seek the Most High. And find a way that you can homeschool, because when you say you can't afford to, it don't cost a lot of money to homeschool. Okay, you're probably spending more money sending your kid to school than you will on materials that you can get for your kid. That you can, most of the material we got when we first started was free stuff. We were getting books, school books from people. We get, you know, we go to garage sales and places like that. You get school, they give you old school books. You can get easy old school books, mm-hmm. you know, that's 10, 15 years old.
But I also wanted to mention, homeschooling also affords you the ability to be creative, where you don't have to have an 8:30 to 3 o'clock school day.
That's right.
You can do manage homeschool flexible to your schedule.
That's right.
So you also have the ability to teach them during what the schools may have, holidays, during summer breaks. All of that time can be used to school them, even on Sundays.
That's right.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Absolutely. So basically, you know, and like we said before, it doesn't cost a lot to homeschool. It doesn't cost a lot at all, so just try to figure a way. Just stay. You got to be motivated to do it, you know, because I've seen so many times where, let me say this, okay, I went through public schools, right, Detroit public schools. I wouldn't send a kid to them schools for nothing in the world. The stuff that I was exposed to in junior high even was bad. But when I got to high school, let me tell you something. It was like drugs everywhere. Drugs, there was murder, there was sex, there was all kinds of junk going on in the schools. I mean, we're talking about a large scale of it. Every kid was involved in this stuff. I was like, man, you know, I started skipping school. I would be out of school, be at school, and it would miss 3-4 days a week because I just didn't want to be in the middle of all that crazy stuff. You know, gangs up in there, you know, gambling, you name it. It was all of that was going on, you know. And that was before the gun time came in. My days we had knives. Mm-hmm. You know, then when the guns came out, I reckon it got even worse. Mm-hmm. You know, and so I wouldn't put no kid in that.
No, and if it's something you really want to do and you really want to remove your children from that, you seek the Most High, there are so many different options. Yeah. Other people may step forward. Mm-hmm. The Most High, His ways are above our ways.
That's right.
So all we can encourage you to do, we're just sharing with you our experiences and, you know, from different angles. You just have to decide as the parent if this is something. It was a decision. Again, I'll just share my short testimony. When my son was born, my sister told me that I was not going to be able to send him to school. And I'm like, okay, you want something special. Her eyes are more open in regard to how the system worked than mine at that time. I was not walking with Yah, not even a Christian at the time. And so as he got older, she just kept telling me, you're not going to be able to send him to school. I sent him to Head Start. And an Israelite co-teacher came to me and said, do not send him to public school. That was the Most High. Again, I was not in the truth. I was living a wicked life. I'm like, why did that lady say that to me? Just out of nowhere. He's in Head Start. So then he went to first and second grade. And then I noticed the teacher started making more complaints. You know, he'll get out of his seat. And I'm like, you know, what's wrong? So finally, they brought me in for a meeting. And what I found out years later is that they were directing me to send my black male child, which is something, if you research it, it's known more about now, into special education. Mm-hmm. And that is what the goal was. I just could not understand why they kept complaining. Yeah. He won't sit down. You know, I'm like, you know, so there is an absolute agenda. So by the time he got to the third grade, it was just to the point where I was just like, Father in heaven, if you want me to bring this child home and educate him myself, I don't know what to do. I don't understand everything. I don't know where the resources are coming from, but I throw up my hands and I say, if it is your will for me to bring this boy home, you make a way out of no way. So I began to look around in the area for other women that homeschool. And the Most High brought women into my life. They gave me books. They brought me into their started taking us on field trips because I cried out. I said, not my will, your will be done. Mm-hmm. I don't know what I'm doing. I don't know how you're going to do it, but I'm going to be obedient if you show me and you give me the resources.
That's
so
right.
For those, when you really want to do it and you really want to surrender, doors will open up. That's all
That's
I
right.
can say. But when you don't want to do it and you're looking for excuses,
yeah.
they'll block it. Like the brother
yeah,
said earlier.
Exactly.
But I just threw up my hands and I said, your will be done. The women came, the resources came,
wow.
and I brought my son home and I homeschooled him.
Yeah, you hear that? Wow.
Yes,
to Yah be the glory.
Yes,
mm-hmm.
to Yah be Yah.
Mm-hmm.
Even Sister Ashley here, she says she can't tell you how many times she's regretted pursuing college to learn stuff mm-hmm. that will mean nothing to her when things get flipped.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so even that, I believe, has been tarnished. I don't completely discount it because there are things that you can definitely learn, certain trades that you can seek after. But for the most part, they're just selling you mm-hmm. bills. They're selling you debt. And a lot
yeah.
of people are going into, because they have classes for everything now.
Yeah.
Classes for everything. And they promote these things to you and have you believing that you're going to come out and land this amazing job.
Not true.
When really, all you're going to do is run up all of this debt.
Yeah.
And you're going to spend a good portion of your life trying to pay it back.
Exactly.
You see, and so all of this, the Western way of living and thinking has become a trap
yeah.
to us.
That's right. It's a business.
And so it's going to take discernment to figure out what to do with your life
mm-hmm.
in the land of our captivity.
That's right.
And I want to make myself abundantly clear to even to our brothers and sisters that's in the truth and that know better, you know, that have their children in these public schools. The scripture says, do not tempt Yahuwah Elohim. So if you know what these teachers and what the system is about, you have to get your children out in homeschool.
Mm-hmm.
Don't tempt Yah.
Yes, that's
because
right.
Because we know if things hit the fan, like the Ak was talking earlier, You're not going to get your children.
You're not.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
You're not.
But you're going to do that.
They lock it down.
They practice it. That's right.
They have these fake calls.
Yes, they do.
Oh, there was a bomb threat. Mm-hmm. And they'll lock down the school. And you won't even know about it. Then they'll send you a letter later on. We had to lock down the school today.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
In the case of an event, you won't be able to get your children unless we notify you.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's true.
You gotta be careful.
I have to do it. And I'm like, I knew it. Mm-hmm. Oh, just in case of running. No. Yeah, we do.
There are things going on behind the scenes, family, that we are not aware of.
Yeah.
They're doing things, and they're manipulating things, and your children are a target.
Yes,
I believe that when you put them there, you're basically putting them out in the open to be a target. A lot of children go in, they go in smart, they come out confused, okay? Notice I say they go in smart. When they're very young, they're very smart and wise in their own little way, and as they grow within the system, they actually start to diminish with common sense, because they're taking it out of them. I've seen little children that are so bright when they're young, and they go in the public school system and it all disappears, and they just gravitate towards other things. And one of the biggest labels that they put on especially male children is ADHD. And I'm starting to see them do this with girls as well. And the first thing they do is they want to pop pills in their mouth. And the parents go along with it, because everybody's in on this together. The government is too. The parent gets a check. The government, that's what I was going to say, the government is in on it too, because they say, take your children to the hospital. Get them checked out. They kind of drop this in their ears. Hey, I think my child may have ADHD.
Yeah.
And so when you say that, the doctors say, oh, I think you're right. Let's write him a prescription. And the reason why I know this is because they tried that with our son, Aliyah.
Sure did.
And we said, we are not interested in your checks. Mm-hmm. Now, how can this teacher tell us that our child may have something? She's not a doctor. She's a teacher. Okay?
Absolutely.
And with her putting that out there, imagine the number of parents who say, okay, I think I am going to get them checked out. And I can get a check, too? They actually tried to sell that to us. You know your family can get a check.
Yeah, they sure did.
Because they know that most people will sell their children out for a check.
Wow.
Yes. Yes, absolutely.
Yeah, them drugs, I tell you, that what they call that, Ritalin is like kitty crack or something. You know, when kids get on that stuff and be
just
like,
them up and get some hooked on other things as they get older.
As they get older, that's right.
They're just waiting for them. They got a jail cell waiting for them. You know.
Yeah, it's so bad when you really, I look back at my life, and I know the Most High was guiding me, because I look at all the stuff that was around me in school and high school and through the neighborhood, and it's like, whew. Well, I wouldn't want nobody to go through that path, because it's like you just don't know. It took the Most High to get me through it. You know, so like I say, these schools, and one person said from school to the what do you call it? The prison pipeline system.
That's what it is. That's what happens.
You know?
$400 million
Hey, the same thing happened in Detroit. They closed out all of my old high schools, closed down. I think your old high school closed down.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's like they closed out so many high schools in Detroit. So many public schools. You just drive around, you see these vacant schools.
Yeah.
It's like, man.
I would like to say this to the young lady too, who asked the question. We are in no way putting you down. We understand your situation. No one here is putting you down. We're actually trying to offer some help and something for you to think about. Like the one sister stated, if you homeschool, it doesn't have to be in the morning hours. You can do it in the evening or in between times when you come home from work. Just doing the best that you can. It wasn't meant as an insult. We don't wish to offend you in that regard, because we do understand it is hard and it's difficult.
That's right.
But we have to look at it as a thing that's necessary. If you look at it like this is something that is necessary, as if my child's life depends on it.
Yeah, it's necessary.
That's the best way to look at this. My child's life depends on it. When it's all said and done, it really does. Your child's life really does depend on this. And I know that sounds so dismal, but when you look at the things that are happening in the public school, the miseducation, the food that they're feeding them.
Spirits they're picking up from other kids.
Exactly. When you look at all of those things, the things that they can pick up in the public school system, then you can see where we're coming from with saying, at any cost, you need to get your children out of there. Consider this as a rescuing of your children.
Yeah.
Okay?
You know, I remember years ago when... I'm going to tell you, I remember how I was, okay? And I enjoyed the quietness when my kids would go off to school, you know? They would go off to school, we only have two of the smallest ones there, and they would be out there. I said, man, it's so peaceful, so quiet when they all go. Can't they just, let's keep them in the school, you know? It felt good, I ain't going to lie to you. It felt good to sit back and be able to hear your thoughts for a change, you know? But when Aliyah went through that stuff at the school, and I saw that stress on him, that boy had so much stress on him, I could see it on him. He was just bothered by it, you know? Mm-hmm. And then I'll never forget, right after he was feeling all that stress, I saw a article or there was a video about this young boy that took his own life because he was feeling so much stress. And he was scared of the teacher was going to get him, you know, that he went and took his life because he didn't want to face that teacher. Mm-hmm. When I saw that, I said, you know what? No kid needs to be experiencing this kind of crazy stress.
Yes.
And I remember when I was growing up in junior high, I had the stress of bullies. You know, I mean, serious bullies that look like they want to kill you, you know, in junior high. You know, we ain't talking about high school. I'm talking about, here I am in the sixth grade, and I got this big old boy looking like he gonna kill me and stuff, you know? I mean, this is a very real thing that kids have to go through, you know? And I've had several times I had bullies, this is like, it was like, on me, like they'd come and just take whatever I had, and I was a little fella at the time, you know? They were much bigger, you know? And the most, I always got them back, though. He always got them back. He sure did. Them bullies were always getting at me, and things were happening to him, and I was like, wow, I was thankful. But I'm telling you, no kid need to experience that kind of stress. You know? They just don't need to. They already going to have enough stuff going on in life. They don't need to experience that too.
Yeah, and like this sister here, she says her daughter's biggest problems are dealing with other kids who have issues.
Yeah.
And so...
Yes. Yeah.
So now it's school, not just the education, it's their peers as well.
Yeah, now school wouldn't be so bad if all the kids were the same. You know, if they all had good spirits and all was well, was nice, but it's not just bad education, but it's kids that's coming in the classroom that's bringing spirits. Some of them may have demons, you know? All of that stuff.
Okay, well, we're not seeing any other questions at the moment, so...
Well, we had a good time today going over the Word, and don't forget what today's lesson was about, okay? The trying of your faith is more precious than gold, okay? So understand the things that you go through, most high, he knows what he's doing. He's taking you through some things. Sometimes it's to teach you some very valuable lessons. Sometimes it's to build you up, to build up your faith. Sometimes he lets you go through things to get you to come against that thing, you know? He's trying to get you, teach you how to fight, you see? And so it could be some of any of those things. So don't think it's strange because you're going through these things.
Yes.
It all has a purpose. And sometimes the Most High may even be silent in it because he's trying to get you to pray harder. Mm-hmm. You know, you're not praying hard enough. You're not seeking him hard enough. So sometimes he let things happen for those reasons. But remember, it's more precious than gold what you're going through. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
That trial.
Mm-hmm.
The scripture says, count it all joy, right? Mm-hmm. Hallelujah. Well, on that note, we're going to say we love you all.
We love you, family, and we want you to enjoy the rest of your Shabbat.
Enjoy the rest of your day. Continue to pray for us. Hallelujah. We'll pray for you all. On that note, we're going to say,
Shabbat shalom.
Shabbat shalom, family.